This tutorial shows how to conduct the repeated measures one-way ANOVA in SPSS and interpret its results. Its purpose is testing the means of the same individuals at three or more points in time for differences. For example, I want to see how good a three-week exercise plan performs. That means, before implementation, I record the physical condition in some form of a test score, which is often considered as the baseline measurement. After the conclusion of the three-week exercise plan, the same test is performed again, and a final time after three more weeks. I use the repeated measures one-way ANOVA to test for a difference in the average test score over time. The requirements for the repeated measures ANOVA are the following: three or more measurements for the same individuals, a dependent variable on the interval or ratio scale, normally distributed dependent variables for each measurement, and equal variances of the differences for the measurements, also called sphericity. Testing for normal distribution is shown in a separate video to keep this one as concise as possible. Sphericity testing is based on the model calculation and will be shown during this video. To conduct the repeated measures ANOVA, go to Analyze, General Linear Model, Repeated Measures. First, define your within subject factor. I will simply call it time. Second, I need to specify the number of levels. Since I have three measurements, I will simply enter 3. Then click Add and proceed with Define. In the following dialog, I will put my measurements for the within subject factor into the within subjects variables box. Under Plots, I can request a line or bar chart by putting the time factor on the horizontal axis and clicking Add. In addition, click the Options button and check Descriptive Statistics. Other options are not necessary for now and will be discussed in separate videos, which you can find in the description and info cards. As a first step, I want to look at the descriptive statistics to get a first idea of my data. My baseline shows a mean of 24.3. The first follow-up measure shows a mean of 27.3 and 28.4 for the second follow-up measure. The standard deviations are somewhat comparable, showing a rather low spread. We have also visualized the means in the plot, which can be found at the very bottom of your output. Note that a box plot might be more helpful, showing you the distribution of the test variable for each measurement in more detail. As promised, I will now test for sphericity. The null hypothesis for this test assumes equal variances for the differences. If your p-value is above the predefined threshold, you can observe sphericity in your data. In my case, the p-value is large enough to assume sphericity. Be careful though. Like many other analytical tests where you don't want to reject the null hypothesis, larger samples lead to a false rejection of it and small samples to a false retention. In short, you most often run the risk of committing a type 1 or type 2 error with Moseley's test. Field therefore recommends using a correction regardless of Moseley's test results. Look at the Tests of Within Subjects effects table for that. If your degrees of freedom in the Greenhouse Geyser GG and Hunfeld HF line are not different from those of the line with sphericity assumed, no correction is necessary. Since that seldomly is the case, what correction should be chosen now? There is a debate about the choice of GG or HF based on the size of epsilon in the Moseley's test table. I would suggest reporting both, since only the degrees of freedom are adjusted. Furthermore, Field 2018 on the pages 671 and 672 suggests taking the mean of the two p-values and also stresses that decisions only based on comparing the p-values with an alpha level should be avoided and supplemented with effect sizes, which will be discussed in the linked video. Always consider context and prior evidence when interpreting your results. Now, let's get to the results for my example. It's pretty obvious my p-values are so small that the development of my measurements over time is very unlikely attributed to chance alone. Or put another way, the intervention seems to have changed the test score of my test subjects. In addition to my descriptive statistics and the profile plot, I can observe an overall increase. After a repeated measures one-way ANOVA with an observable effect, post-hoc tests should be calculated to see between which of the measurements differences exist. An effect size for the repeated measures one-way ANOVA itself is optional. The two videos shown now will show you how to do both.